My grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
A land acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Hello and welcome. My name is John. I just want to welcome you to tonight's program, Along the Western Front, presented in partnership with the Chinook Country Historical Society. The duration of this program is an hour and a half. If this is your first Zoom program, you can sit back and enjoy. We've muted everyone, so you don't need to worry about that aspect of things. To ask questions, please use the chat feature that's sort of in the middle there. In the last half hour of the program, we'll get to as many of those questions and provide some answers as we can. And now I'd like to introduce Jackie Kleiner, the president of the Chinook Country Historical Society.
Thank you, John. Welcome, everybody. On behalf of Chinook Country Historical Society, and in collaboration with the Calgary Public Library, we are very pleased to bring you this presentation tonight, and I will introduce our speaker in just a few moments. I just wanted to point out as well that we have another presentation coming up next week. We've just added this on December 9th at 6:30, and it will look at the topic of Métis winter festivals and festivities. So I think you will find that very interesting. If you can join us, and registration is available now on calgarylibrary.ca. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Leah Hennel. A little bit about Leah. So while she was in high school, she jumped at a chance to explore a work experience option at the Calgary Sun in the photography department. And this began her lifelong interest and career in photography. This practicum was the best thing that ever happened to her, she says, as it opened her eyes to this exciting field and led her to SATE in the photojournalism program, from which she graduated in 1998. She's built a fulfilling career at Calgary's daily newspapers, both the Sun and the Herald, and continues her work in photojournalism today. She's traveled all over Alberta, and that will be evident in some of the pictures we're going to see tonight, and most parts of Canada, as well as Europe and Africa. She's won many awards along the way, but what's most important to her as a photographer is that it doesn't feel like a job, and it really is her passion. She lives in Calgary and continues, as I said, her work as a photojournalist. Leah's book, Along the Western Front, which we'll hear about tonight, if you are interested, will be available or is available at the Camera Store, at Chapters, and on Amazon. So without further ado, over to you, Leah.
Thanks so much, Jackie. Okay, I'm going to... So sorry for everyone, I haven't done these Zoom call like this, so bear with me. And I'll just share my screen here. So I hope everyone can see that. So just a bit of nuts and bolts about me. I grew up in Calgary. I spent a lot of time on the family farm where my dad grew up. That's where I kind of got the appreciation for the Western life. And I've been intrigued by with it ever since. So these photos that I'm going to show, some of them are in the book. Most of this is just my passion project that I kind of chip away with. So here we go. So this is, I don't know if any of you know, Lenore Buse McLean. I met Lenore in 2000 at the Calgary Stampede. She was one of three women who were picked for this Alberta beef campaign. And Lenore was one of the first ones I met who allowed me to photograph her. So I have been photographing Lenore and her family probably for 20 years. What's interesting about Lenore is that, well, there's many interesting things about Lenore. Lenore grew up on the near Stimson Creek, near Pincher Creek, but she was also a neighbor of Florence Ledoux, who was the wife of Guy Wiedek, who started the Calgary Stampede in 1912. So Lenore has many interesting stories. And one of Lenore's quotes that I love is that she said she wanted a good horse and a good man, and she found both. She was married to Roy for a long time, and they raised three boys. This is Lenore on a ranch. This is a recent photo I took of Lenore. She just celebrated her 80th birthday. And the funny story about this, you probably can't see it, but Lenore lives in this beautiful, amazing landscape. And I had just bought a new vehicle, this Toyota RAV4, and I drove it up into these hills over the cow paddies with my son to get this photo as Lenore went up in horseback. And like many, I found it is much easier to go on horseback up there. If I'm going too fast on these slides, someone let me know. And this is Lenore again in her home. A lot of the times when I photograph people, I like to become close to my subjects. I like to get to know them. You know, they're allowing me into their life. And with Lenore, we just hit it off again, like I said, right away. So I always, when I'm out for a drive in the country, I'll phone her and stop in. And sometimes I'm lucky enough that she's preparing an amazing roast beef meal for me. this is another ranch that I go to. Branding time usually happens in Alberta, Southern Alberta, between May and June, maybe beginning of July sometimes. And this is at the Bar S Ranch with the Chataways. And I've been photographing them and their branding probably for 10, 15 years now. So here's a view of the ranch, the branding pen. A photographer, a friend of mine, Mike Drew, who's a big mentor and a really close friend, you know, he always taught me to get to bend down, get low to the ground, get different angles. So at branding time, this is when, I mean, I'm probably the most annoying photographer. I hope I'm not, but I tend to get fairly close to the action. So this is just, again, at branding, some of the young boys. Again, branding time is one of my favorites. It's when the whole community, the neighbors, everyone comes in and helps out. So this is just lunch break on the ranch. And this is, again, the Bar S Ranch. Just other low angles. I love the detail shots. I love a lot of the ranches I shoot, and the Western style is more of the buckaroo style, which I just love. I know a lot of people, most of these photos I'm showing you right now are black and white. And sometimes you just know when you're going in to photograph someone or a subject that it just lends itself better to black and white, sometimes color. I never really know what I'm going to photograph, whether it be black and white or color, until I get there. Some of these photos I'm showing you, a lot of them are older negatives, and of course digital. I started my career shooting film, and now I'm shooting digital. Again, the tight details on the hands, the shaps, the knife. Again, this is at branding. I do tend to shoot, photograph a lot of brandings. It's just a photographer's paradise, really. There's a lot of action going on. A lot of people, great people to meet and have conversations with. Most of these ranches, the Bar S and the Lazy U Ranch that I'll be showing, most of those ranches started in about 1883. This is Scott Chataway, and this again is on the Bar S Ranch, which is near Nanton, in the Williams Creek Coulee. And all the dust and that stuff is from, most of you maybe have been to a branding, so the smoke is from the hot iron. Anywhere I travel, especially in Southern Alberta, I like to photograph a lot of the younger generation. Here's some kids that are practicing lassoing on each other instead of on the calves. This just shows Alberta, great big open sky country. This again was on the Bar S Ranch at Branding in just last year, actually. I haven't gone to any, obviously, since the pandemic in 2020. So this was the last Branding I photographed, actually. And this again, this shows I'm very close to her. I could reach out my hand and touch the horse. I'm just following along as she's about to rope some steers. Lately, I've been photographing a lot of women ranchers. I look at them as like the original working mom. With Lenore, this is Jenny Donahue out near Sierra West Cabins. Her and her husband run that place. Stories like Lenore McLean going back, she would tell me she'd have her baby in the front of her on the saddle, and was, checking fences, roping horses, and then went and made a meal. So I've sort of turned my focus now to photographing and doing portraits of women ranchers. And this is Jenny and her husband, Randy Donahue. I go to a lot of rodeos. This one, friend and colleague Mike Drew told me about, riding on stone rodeo. And it is probably my favorite rodeo, small town rodeo to photograph. It's looks like it's right out of a Western movie. It's just amazing landscape. I can get immersed into the action. Like you're literally as close as you can be to the rodeo. You can go anywhere. It's not like shooting big rodeos like the Stampede. And this is Bailey. She's 15 here and she's a steer rider. And at the time you age out at 15 when you ride steers. So her next year she would have had to practice riding bulls and she wanted to be a bull rider. She's since kind of changed her focus a bit, but at that time, 2 years ago, she was the only female steer rider that was at the Riding on Stone Rodeo. This is at the Riding on Stone Rodeo again, barrel racing. And this this is Carrie Ann Breton. And again, again at this rodeo, I'm laying on my stomach. I'm right on the ground. I mean, it's just an amazing place to go, even when there's not a rodeo to go. There's a lot of history, a lot of Indigenous history in Riding on Stone. So I recommend for everyone to go check it out. This is Sam Mitchell. So 2 years ago, they started side saddle racing at the Calgary Stampede. And so again, this is just most of the stuff I'm photographing, and people were wondering, is available light. So I don't bring a lot of gear with me. I go very light. And this is just available light, barn door open in the barns at this Calgary Stampede. And this is side saddle racer Sam Mitchell. This is another side saddle racer, Jesse DuPont. And this one, I just like, how she's standing there posed. She looks like, out of an old Wild West movie. I just loved how she was standing. So I took the photo of her, and again, it's in the barn. And this portrait is of Carly Weaselchild. And I took this one at the Siksika Powwow about probably a few years ago. I can't even remember now. Just the light was perfect. I think actually I might have lit that with a reflector that my husband was holding. Carly was the First Nations princess for the Calgary Stampede, I believe in 2016 or 2015. I had met her then and we just kept in contact, and I've been photographing her for a while now. This portrait is probably one of my favorites and probably the easiest one I've ever taken. This is Cade McDonald, novice steer rider, from Saskatchewan, and he was competing at the Calgary Stampede. It had just a torrential downpour like it usually does during Stampede during Cade's ride, and he fell off. So of course, this is what happens when the ground was muddy, and Cade had just walked out of the dressing room and I saw him and I just said, is it okay if I take your portrait real quick? And yeah, this was a young steer wrestle right after his ride. So the way the mud just kind of fell so symmetrical on that one side of his face and around his eyes just worked. So I've spent a lot of time photographing Hutterites in southern and central Alberta, probably for 20 years now. The first hut colony I went to, I probably spent about a couple months just getting to know the community there. I didn't take any photos. I'm being very respectful, and I love photographing different communities, different cultures than my own. So I think that kind of showed. And Cheyenne Gross from the Pincher Creek colony. So this was during their branding, and I've been invited back to their branding a few years in a row now, obviously not this year because of COVID. So this is her. So I'm just going to show you, I'm going to go back for 1 second. Okay. I kind of skipped around. I'm kind of showing you a little bit of portraits here. Portraits are my favorites. I just think they show so much in people's eyes. And I just love shooting portraits. This, was from the Nanton Night Rodeo. And this is the bull rider Daryl Dixon from Eden Valley. And he was competing. He had just finished competing when I photographed him, and he competed with a broken collarbone. So him and I were chatting and he was telling me about this. And I just think, I mean, to be a bull rider and then to get on the bull with a broken collarbone, that takes some strength and some skill. So that is him. And this is from another portrait again. This is Chloe Studer. She's from Saskatchewan, and this was taken at the Calgary Stampede. And at the time, so that would have, this was 2019. So at the time, Chloe was the first active female outrider. There was another female outrider, I think 20 years before that. But at this time, Chloe was the first active female outrider. And she, at 18, she was also the youngest on the Canadian Chuckwagon professional circuit. So it was a big story. And I had met Chloe because I was photographing a female chuckwagon driver from Saskatchewan who would have been, if she competed at the Calgary Stampede that year, the first female chuckwagon driver. So again, I've kind of taken a focus over, I've been looking for those, doing more female ranching photos and rodeo photos, stuff like that. This is another one from the Nanton Night Rodeo. Again, this is a small town rodeo. I'm right in the chutes, right up beside the rider. And the reason why I love this rodeo is it usually starts in the evening. So same with the Milk River Rodeo, that first night, it starts at 7 p.m. And in the summer, that's the golden hour. That's like the best time to photograph. So the light just keeps getting better and better and better. This night, I got lucky with the rainbow in the background and just the way the light hit the bronc rider, it just kind of worked out perfectly. And the whole time I'm photographing too, I'm always thinking about what is in my frame, what my background is. I don't like very cluttered backgrounds. Everything that's in the background to me has to have a reason for being there. This is the Milk River, writing on Stone Rodeo. And again, the light, I mean, it's golden hour, it's fantastic light. A couple of years ago, my family and I usually have my son with me and my husband, and I went down to photograph it, and there was a rattlesnake in the middle of the field. So they stopped the whole rodeo, and this old cowboy went out there with a garbage can, picked up the rattlesnake and just threw him in the garbage can and went and released the rattlesnake. And so you never know what you're going to see down there. And there's tons of rattlesnakes, which is very cool. Again, here's writing on Stone Rodeo. So you can just see the background is just amazing. It just reminds me of an old John Ware cowboy movie. John Wayne, sorry. John Ware, different person. And this is writing on Stone Rodeo again. This just shows you how close you can get to the action at some of these small town rodeos. So there is kind of like a barbed wire fence that's right in front of me. I'm on my stomach, but I can hear the horse, you know, the breath breathing on me, and just reach out and touch them. And this one, because of those rocks flying, the rock did hit my lens and my lens did break. So my husband and son were standing behind me and probably not too impressed that I'd have to buy a new lens, but, and of course I'm so close, I didn't get the rider fully in that photo, but it, just to show you how close you get to the action. That being said, I just want to say too, for these small town rodeos, because I'm so used to photographing them, I do know where it's safe to stand. I don't recommend it for some people who haven't done it before. This is the Milk River after a hot rodeo. Lots of the cowboys, cowgirls will go and take their horses in and cool off. So this is just a lot of the stuff I like to photograph is behind the scenes, not necessarily the action, but kind of what happens on the, you know, behind the action on the outskirts of it. And again, just the horses are cooling off. They love the water and they love to swim. So they're just having a little bath in the Milk River. And this is getting later into the evening at the rodeo. So again, I just like trying to get different angles and behind the scenes to shoot some of the action. Most of this stuff you can't really do at the bigger rodeos. And these are, again, both these last two slides are from the Writing on Stone Rodeo. So into the evening. Here's just a rider taking an afternoon nap before he competes. Again, I just like those behind the scenes moment, those, you know, little quiet moments. This is Stephen Peebles, and this is before he competes, before he rides at the Calgary Stampede. This is in the dressing room. So again, I like going in behind the scenes because I've photographed at the Calgary Stampede for over 20 years now. I'm lucky enough that I can go backstage and behind the scenes to get these moments. I like peeking behind the curtain and photographing stuff that people don't usually get a chance to see, because what you see is happening right on the infield. So this is another branding, and this is at the Lazy U Ranch. And I've been photographing that ranch and the Jenkins for probably another 20 years. I've gotten to know these families. I just love this. I mean, if this cowboy boot can tell a story, imagine what it could say. I love the details. The craftsmanship you can see even in the spur there on the buckle is, those are like the details that I like. Again, with framing, my eye is going right to the rider on the horse with the old, the buckaroo style tapaderos. The detail and the craftsmanship on that is amazing. So I tend to focus on a lot of that stuff while the branding and all that action is going on. This is at the Lazy U Ranch. This is with Dana and Kobe Hare. This is down near Pincher Creek. Just a different angle from the same ranch, same branding day. And this is a branding at the Pincher Creek Colony. And this is Lillian Gross on the left there. And she's helping to wrestle the calf. I love the taking photos here too. And I love how the Hutterite women, they have the jeans on underneath their dresses while they're helping out. At branding time, everybody helps out on the ranch. Kids, everybody. That's another one from the Pincher Creek Colony, and this is Lillian. I love photographing in Southern Alberta. I mean, just big open skies and grasslands. So I think in a lot of my photos, you'll see those. I tend to try and frame portraits with those big, big, big skies behind them. This was a windy day, like it always is down in Southern Alberta. So their dresses are flying. This is at the Spring Point Hutterite Colony, which is not too far from the Pincher Creek one. And this was during sheep shearing. So you could see down in the coulee there, all the sheep after they've been sheared. And these were two little girls that had helped out. And it was hot down in that barn, so they were just having a break sitting on top of the hill. And this was March 2019, right before COVID hit Calgary and we got locked down. So this was the last time I was at that colony too. Almost looks like you think she's going to spill her drink because she's laying down with the can of Coke there. This was after a branding at the Pincher Creek Colony. I usually stay there and I have dinner. They're lovely and they invite me to stay and have dinner with them. So again, a lot of the times I focus on the kids and taking photos of them. So this is just some of the girls laying in the buffalo beans there on a hot summer day after a branding. And here's some from the sheep shearing at Spring Point Colony. I did try my hand at trying to shear the sheep, but there's definitely a knack to it, and I'm not good at it. And this is just a young boy from the Spring Point Colony. Again, I look for faces in a crowd. Different faces that I think would make a good portrait. So he was kind enough to stand there and pose for me. Their reflection, the light is coming from, there was a table in front of him and there's a white tablecloth. So it's reflecting some of that light back onto his face. These are some of the, my family, we have a cabin up at Buffalo Lake near Stettler, Alberta. So my family and I were driving out there, and this is the Red Deer River at Mackenzie Crossing. my husband was driving, he looked over and he's like, look, there's women swimming in the river. So of course I said, we have to turn around. So we went down there. They had just finished berry picking that day. So I waved to them from the shore and asked if I could take some photos of them cooling off in the river. This is just, again, I drive a lot in Southern Alberta. So this is just from one of those drives when the light was amazing and everything just worked out. And yeah, the horses, the clouds, the light. This was for a story I actually was working on for the Calgary Herald at the time. During, I can't remember the year, the Calgary Stampede, but it was the first year that they had Indigenous relay racing at the Stampede. So this was at, this is Team Lone Wolf relay racers. So it's Aaron Goodrider and jockey Cal Jackson on the horse. And this was at Begani Nation. And I had phoned them and I said, I'm on my way to come photograph you guys while they were practicing their circuit. As soon as my husband was coming with me, I needed someone to help hold the light. So this one I did light. As soon as we pulled in there, a huge storm came in, and this photo, I think I got maybe two frames. I didn't get a chance to photograph them practicing because there was lightning and the storm came, so they had to leave. So this was kind of one of those, just a lucky portrait that worked out with that crazy sky that came in. This is Tom Views, who is actually Lenore McLean, who I talked about in the beginning. This is her brother. And this is Tom on his horse, Big Enough. And again, it seemed like a lot of the portraits I was taking, or every time I was going out to take a photo on a ranch, a big storm, Alberta sky storms would come in. So sometimes it works out. In the last two cases, it did. So this one, it worked out, and it's, I have a light on my camera right that's lighting Tom and his horse. And then my car headlights are actually lighting the tree trunk down at the bottom there. So that just worked. It just worked out. And as soon as I took this photo, a hailstorm came in and we had to go hide in the barn. This photo is from the 2005 Calgary Stampede Horse Drive. This is the horses that the stock horses that bringing in from Hannah at the Stampede Ranch into the Calgary Stampede. This was their stock. So I went with them on this trail ride. This photo was taken near Dorothy, Alberta. And yeah, that was probably one of the most amazing experiences I had photographing this horse drive. They had one that I went on in 2000 as well. Again, just some more tight detail stuff of a cowboy sharpening his branding knife during branding. I've just always wanted to get that photo where they're sharpening it, and I've never gotten it in all my brandings I've been to until just last year. This is Dana and Kobe Hare and their daughter Riata. Dana Jenkins Hare. I've been photographing Dana since she was 10. She now, since this photo, has two more girls, but I become great friends with them. So I tend to come down to their brandings whenever I can. So this is at their barn there, just a barn door light. I just opened the barn door and they posed. Yeah. This is just another close-up of Kobe. At the time when he had his beard, now he's just got his mustache. Again, I love portraits. I could stare at a good portrait forever. This This is another one of Dana Hare and her little girl Riata. So she's just getting her in the truck. This is probably one of my favorite photos. I don't know why. I usually don't like any of my photos really. I think we're our own worst critics, but this one I just like. I don't know why. If it's like the old farm truck, it reminds me of my uncle's old trucks that they had on the farm. But just something about showing like a working mom on the ranch appeals to me as well. Maybe because I am a mom, but yeah, just the rope there, her old boots and getting her little girl in. Here's a shot from when she sat Riata in the truck so she can tighten up her chaps before they went out for a ride. I just think it's funny, the little one peeking out the window. But again, these old trucks appeal to me. I wish I had one. This is a recent portrait I actually took of Mac Blades for a freelance story that I was working on for the Narwhal. This is in their old cabin up in the Livingstone range there. And this is just him looking out the door of their old cabin. So Mac, the Blades, actually, they ranch just across the road from the Bar S Ranch where the Chataways are. And I've met Mac before at some of their branding, so. This is JB Mooney, bull rider. This was again, just before his ride at the Calgary Stampede, in behind the dressing room there that they get ready in. So he was just coming out for a smoke break and great eyes, smoking, asked if I could take his photo. He's easygoing, said, sure, why not? So yeah, there you go. This is taken from a drone, and this is out at the Bar S Ranch during branding. I don't do a lot of drone photography, so this is probably one of the few, but it's just showing, those are their branding pins, and just this must have been in, I think in June. This is during harvest. I love photographing during harvest time. Again, lots of the times I get lucky sometimes with the sky. So this is when a thunderstorm had just rolled through down near Pincher Creek. So this is looking west, this photo, and I just wanted to show the difference of looking west, same, almost exact same moment, looking to the east, and again, a storm, but I got the rainbow and some of the crop. So it goes to show you, you just have to turn around sometimes, you can get two photos, two totally different photos in amazing light again. Lots of what I do is driving in the country, because my background is in photojournalism and working in newspapers. A lot of the times I would just take off into the country after a hard day or tough news assignment and clear my head and just go for a drive. This, if some of you recognize that area, is down near southern Alberta. This is Kobe Hare and up at their ranch, the Lazy U Ranch, just riding on the ridge. I lucked out with that Chinook arch and then the line of the hill, and he's just riding in there. Okay, so this is my last slide that I have to show you. This one is of, so this is Roy McLean's memorial service in High River. Lenore, who I talked about in the beginning, this is her husband's memorial service. The boots backward in the stirrups is a cowboy funeral tradition. I've only seen it a couple times at funerals, but this is, so those are Roy's boots and you turn them backwards and that's Roy's horse. So it's very symbolic, a very Western funeral. And that's it for my last slide. So I don't know if we're going to go to questions.
Sure. That was really stunning photography there. We do have quite a few questions here, so we can transition to that if you'd like. First, kind of going with a few technical sort of things. What sort of setup do you have for your camera? Like, do you tend to like to use wide angle or more zoom lenses or anything different? Or?
That's a good question. I tend to actually for my gear, I'm honestly not a big gear person. Sometimes I use my iPhone, but honestly, the lens I use the most is probably my 35. I do use big zoom lenses sometimes, but for my portrait work and all that stuff, I probably use an 85. I like to get closer to my subjects as well. And if I have the chance to use a wide angle when I'm shooting a rodeo or a branding and get as close as I can, I think that's what I would tend to do the most.
Okay. And changing from gear to, I guess, philosophy on photographs, do you, like a lot of the photographs you showed us tonight are in black and white. Mm-hmm. When it comes to black and white versus color, do you think that's a decision that should be made before you take the picture, or is it okay to do it afterwards, or are you hung up on that kind of thing?
It's a good question. I tend to shoot more black and white for my ranching stuff only because in my head I always think, oh, this reminds me of like an old Western movie or something like that. So in my head I think of it as black and white, but I shoot everything in color. So I photograph primarily on digital. I don't shoot film anymore. I did, and I love digital now. But I shoot everything in color. So when I get back home and in post-production, if I thought I would change it into black and white then, but I'd always have the option of having the color version as well. You know, in the golden hours, sunset, sunrise, or like when there's a rainbow, I'll always shoot color for sure.
It's hard to pass up that opportunity.
Yeah, when the lights go, and then sometimes like the mood, if it's like, if I'm shooting at night, sometimes those like in the city at night for, you know, if I'm doing documentary work on someone and it's at night and you have those green and those different colors or the red lights of a stop sign coming in, I think that to me screams color, but yeah, it's personal preference for sure. But I, sometimes I think about it going ahead. Definitely if I'm doing Western stuff, I think, oh yeah, this is black and white and detail stuff.
Yeah. And do you think that, especially with the Western photography, going with the black and white, do you think that helps you bring sort of the history of the area and the story of the people and the communities that you're taking pictures with more to the forefront? Or
maybe sometimes, I think sometimes a lot of, if there's color, I think it distracts from the photo. And that you would just focus if at the Pincher Creek Colony during branding, some of the women have, you know, the flowers on their dresses, or if it's a very bright color. I mean, they don't tend to wear very bright colors, but if it was I kind of feel like your eye would go to that instead of just looking at the moment, the expressions, that sort of thing. I feel like, yeah. I mean, like the cowboy boot one here, if that one was in color, I don't think it, like there wouldn't be very bright color anywhere. So you would still, yeah, that's a good question. I don't even think I answered that well. Sorry, whoever asked it.
And you mentioned the colonies there, just in your answer there as well. So there's been a few questions kind of relating to how you made those connections. And was it tricky to make the inroads, or how did you go about doing that? Did you just drive up one day and
that's a good question. That is a really good question. So the first colony I went to was in 2000, And I was actually there for a story for the Calgary Herald on the women. It was with a food writer and they were baking bread. So it was a story. She had already phoned them to ask if we could come and photograph them making the bread they were for a food story. So they had said yes. So from that point, then I had to ask the boss of the colony, because most of the Hutterite colonies, there's different, like there's Dariolite, Lariolite, there's different mm-hmm. ones that are more strict and don't want photos and ones that are willing to have you come on. This one that I'm talking about, I befriended the boss, and usually that's the religious leader. They allowed me to come and photograph. And then from there, I got connections to the Pincher Creek one and Spring Point. But yeah, I don't, like I said, a lot of the times I missed a lot of really good photos because, you know, I obviously am respectful. They're letting me into their lives. It's, you know, I'm not just going to start taking photos. So I am very respectful. So yeah, it was hard to get access at some I haven't been allowed back to after for, they change bosses because the someone had passed away, so then another boss is there. So yeah, it varies. I wouldn't recommend, it's a very closed society for sure. Mm-hmm. So even when I'm taking photos with them and telling them if they're going to be in the book, I ask permission. And yeah.
And this sort of, I guess, can kind of go a similar way with any of your connections that you've made and the people taking photographs. Like, how, for this project itself, how long did it take you to collect these photos?
So this is probably, yeah, like a body of work over 20 years. So a long time. Yeah, probably, I'm trying to think, yeah, 20 years. It's a very personal project. So having also something in a book that's very tactile to give to people, it's hard to put stuff out there because I never know what people are going to say. But at the same time, all the subjects in the book, you know, I like the idea that I can give them something tactile. I feel like so much of being a photographer, a photojournalist, is I feel like I keep taking from people and I have nothing to give them back. So having a book and something like that to give them, is amazing.
And do you feel you learned a lot more, or I guess what did you learn about Southern Alberta from the course of this? I mean, that's probably could fill another 5 hours of discussing what you learned probably, but what sort of, is there anything that sticks out about different communities or?
I think what sticks out too is that in Southern Alberta, all the communities, like at least that I found, like on the like ranches, the Hutterite communities, Indigenous communities, but they all get together and get along and help out at branding time. At like, there's all the communities come together. So I think I've learned, I mean, yeah, the neighbors really help each other.
Okay. And diving into some of the other questions here again, you've talked about suffering a cracked camera lens there. Have you, and knowing where to stand and getting that, have you ever been injured yourself while in the pursuit of a good shot?
No, I haven't. That's a good question. I'm trying to think if I have. I mean, I've fallen and slipped on ice before. But no, I should say though, I am really allergic to horses and anything to do with the ranching lifestyle. So it's kind of funny that I gravitate towards it. So, but injured though, but oh, and I can't ride a horse. I'm terrible.
which knocks off another question I was about to ask from the audience here. If you rode,
I wish I did. I mean, that I have fallen off the horse. How about that? Taking photos. Now I remember. I was taking photos, and it's really hard when you're a terrible rider to put down the reins, and then also, well, you hope you have a good horse or put down the reins and take photos. So I fell off. I'm awful. I'm the first one to admit.
Okay. I can't ride one either, so no judgment here. Another question that just came in terms of your book, what sort of balance do you have between the colonies, the ranchers, and the First Nations characters,
balance? That's a good question. I didn't. So the publisher picked the photos that were in the book. I didn't have much control over say over that. I don't know. Yeah, that's a good question. I don't really know how to answer that one.
Okay. And I guess sort of building off of that, did any of your favorite pictures, I know you had mentioned you don't really have too many favorites per se, but did any of your favorites make it in?
A few did. Yep. A lot of my favorites too aren't photographically maybe the best, but they're my favorites because of the story behind the photo. They're my favorite because of my attachment now to the subject I photographed. I should go back saying for portrait, like I love photographing people, but my favorite thing is I'm so curious, and maybe that's part of my background as a photojournalist. I'm very curious to learn about other people. So a lot of my favorite photos are just because I know a story that happened between me and the subject while we were getting to know each other, chatting. Sometimes with some of those rodeo portraits, you know, I only meet them for maybe 10 minutes and then I never talk to them again. But I still try to have that connection somehow.
And I think it definitely comes across, and especially the ones you've shown us tonight. Do you ever have to put subjects at ease when you're taking a picture? And do you have a strategy for doing that?
That's a really good question. I think, like, definitely in my other documentary work outside of the Western photos, that has happened a lot. In terms of this stuff tonight, I mean, putting people at ease, I think everyone, because most people I photograph maybe don't like, I use an example from myself, for example, I don't like to be photographed. So I always just assume that's how my subjects feel too. So I try to talk to them and put them at ease. The way I do it is I tend to photograph. That's why I like brandings. People are busy, they're working, they don't notice that I'm there. I mean, I'm sure they know I'm there with a camera, but you know, they're busy, they're doing something. So it gets their mind off being photographed. Same with portraits. I just try to talk to them and get them to relax and act naturally. I think for a lot of this Western stuff too, with Lenore, especially with Lenore McLean, I met her again, 20 years ago, my son's 16. So when I started photographing as well, on her ranch, when they were branding, I would have my son strapped in front, you know, in the baby carrying case and cameras off the side. So I think maybe I just put people at ease because I looked so ridiculous with a baby and cameras laying down in the dirt taking photos. I put people at ease because I make fun of myself. Maybe that helps.
Okay. And have you ever had to like delete a picture that someone's like, how dare you take that, either for this project or something or other else?
It definitely is a news photographer when you're photographing people outside court. But no, I would never delete it. I've never been asked to delete something outside of photographing people at court who didn't want their photos taken. No, I've never been asked to delete something. I mean, obviously I'm going to respect, some of the stuff I photographed on the Hutterite colonies, I would never put out there in public. Mm. It's nothing bad. It's just that, you know, they would, I would show them some of the photos and ask if they were okay if I published it.
Okay. And you'd mentioned the effect of COVID, that we've all had that mm-hmm. this has been a crazy year. How's the pandemic changed your approach to photography?
That's a really good question. I don't know if it has changed my approach to photography, really, except that I'm not as close to people as I'd want to be photographing. So the question of what lenses I would use maybe have changed now because I, you know, have the separation from them. But other than that, I don't think it has really changed. Maybe changed in the access, because I won't even if I can go onto the colony now or to the ranches, I'd be super careful. I wouldn't go inside. So I've just stayed away from some.
And have many of the events, like the different rodeos, have those continued or have they been postponed at all? Or like, is there a change there?
Yeah, there's a big change there. So some of the rodeos, most of the rodeos have been canceled. That being said, some like Nanton Night ones went, but without spectators. I could have gone, and everyone's wearing a mask except if you're riding. I didn't go, so I could have, but I just stayed away. The brandings, of course, have gone on because they have to. COVID, yeah. Ranch work doesn't stop because of pandemic, so that's still happening. But yeah, definitely some of the Calgary Stampede was not held, right? So yeah, that's been affected for sure. But actual real ranch work hasn't. Well, it has a little bit because they don't have their neighbors come and help as much, right? So.
Yeah. And just getting back to another question from the stream here. You said that you now love digital photography, but do you still do any film photography on occasion? Did we maybe see any film photography tonight at all? Or?
You did see some film photography, but that would have been shot 20 years ago. I don't do any film photography. It's not that, like, I used to have a dark room and all that stuff too. It's not that I don't like film and wouldn't want to get back into it. I just like the digital cameras now are so good that I can concentrate more on the content and what I'm photographing. But that being said, I do want to get, like, I've never shot medium format or large format. So I'd like to learn a new skill that way for sure. The pandemic maybe has changed my work in that I'm trying to branch out and maybe do some of that.
Okay. We've covered quite a lot of the questions in there. If anyone else has more questions, please do contribute to there. And for yourself, Leah, do you have any other things you'd like to elaborate on or any stories you'd like to dive into for some of the background of any portraits or anything?
You can still see my screen. I'm taking it, right?
Yes. Yep.
One moment here. Sorry, guys. I talk too fast.
sorry to put you on the spot too.
Yeah, put me on the spot now. I'm just trying to go back here and show you guys one. Sorry here. I guess I'll go. There was a lot of questions on the Hutterite colonies.
Mm-hmm.
So going back to one of the questions about color and black and white, I do have this photo in color. And it's a big blue sky. The girls' dresses, I think, pink and the light blue with flower print and stuff. But I feel like this photo just wouldn't, I think that people would just look at that blue sky and the color and miss the expression on the woman in the middle and not, you know, the skirts are blowing. I feel like the color would just take away from that. But again, that's just my opinion. You know, every artist has a right to whatever they want. But then going to this one in black and white, I just love this one in color. My eye goes right to the girls, to the color there, which I actually want your eye to go to, is to them laying down there. So again, it's, yeah, personal preference. This one color, I think in black and white, it would have just been lost. So I don't know if that helps explain that.
Yeah, it's a nice way to think about the, because now that you mentioned it, especially, it's like, oh, well, yeah, I think I wouldn't like it if I was showing it in a different perspective, like in coloration versus black and whites there.
Yeah. So but again, it's just, yeah, like.
It's interesting hearing the reasoning behind that, going, that makes sense as to why I looked where I looked, or that sort of thing.
Yeah. Like, I feel like this one, again, if this one was in color, it'd be fine too. But I think the black and white definitely does give it that old timey feel for sure. Yeah, I've always just liked black and white too, just personal preference. When I was at the Herald a couple of times working, they did put on the front page a couple of black and white photos that I had shot. So, which is very rare on a front page.
Definitely, yeah.
So, yeah, it's just personal preference. But I mean, again, when I said the lights, like this in black and white, maybe it would have worked, or this one, but you know, there's just that beautiful golden hour light that, yeah.
Yeah. And are you working on another book anytime soon? Have you started the process?
I have no idea. Maybe. maybe a book on after the pandemic's over and all the, you know, photos of the city during a pandemic. So I've been documenting that. So maybe, yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
And in documenting that, do you think it's kind of been an excuse to get out and see more, or is it as sort of a coping mechanism in a way? Again, not to put you on the spot, but like, do you think it helped you get through a little bit? And
maybe, but I also think it's my job as a photojournalist to document.
Right. Yeah.
Right. So as a photographer, big stories and big news happen, just from my training, we want to be there. But it does help actually, because then you actually get to meet people and you get out of your house. So that does help for sure.
Yeah. But it is important to do that first level of the first chapter of history kind of thing, their first take
right.
of it.
Which is, and like, even with this book, I feel like it's a bit of documenting some of the history of, you know, the communities of Southern Alberta. You know, some of the stuff I didn't include in the book, when someone asked, you know, I have tons of stuff from small towns, just small town life, and that didn't go in there. I think my publisher was like, we have to have kind of a condense it and have a theme, have a direction.
And as someone who's raised in Calgary, went to school in Lethbridge, seeing these photographs, I'm like, I didn't appreciate this as much as I should, because especially seeing it in this light, it's like there's a lot more depth to the stories of what a rodeo is than just, oh yeah, it's a rodeo. Like, it's so it's been very, very good to see that. Not to blow small critic there, but
no, that's good for sure. And I guess I'm different, where I'm a city girl. Like, I grew up in Calgary, but I spent summers on my dad's, on the family farm where my dad grew up. So I was immersed, or I had seen this way of life. The farm's still there, and I went to Brandings on the family farm every May long weekend. I'd like to say that I actually pitched and helped out, but I didn't. I was just taking photos then. So, and a lot of times too, my son comes with me on these too. So from a baby until he can actually ride a horse.
And someone had a question about the writing on stone rodeo and the area around there. Do you have to do that all in one day, or are there areas like hotels and things like that you could stay close by?
You know, there's a campground there. So I'd recommend whoever goes to camp out on the campground, or I do drive that in one day. I think it's 3 hours from Calgary about. But the rodeo, the Friday night or the Saturday night, it's usually every August long weekend. And that rodeo starts at 7 PM. So it's a late drive back if you're going to drive. But, I usually just sleep at the rodeo grounds in the back of my car. If people are willing to do that, there is hotels. Milk River is close. I think there's a motel there.
So just digging through to see if there's any ones that I missed here. potentially interesting one. What photo do you really want to take that you haven't taken yet? If there's something you want to photograph that you haven't
been able
to.
That's a really good question. And actually there is. For 20 years, I have wanted to go to the Yamal Peninsula near Siberia and live and photograph the reindeer herders. So much so I even took Russian at university, a night course. I can't speak a word. I'm not very good at languages, but yeah, that's my dream, to live with the reindeer herders for like a year. It's been my dream for 20 years, so we'll see if it happens.
Maybe that could be the next book, right?
Exactly, if someone wants to send me there. I also should say I love traveling, but really hate the process. I don't like flying.
Someone was noting the lack of winter photographs in here. Is there any particular reason?
That is a good question. There's some in the book. That's a really good question. I just didn't put them in the slideshow. Yes, I do have winter photographs of branching because, again, it doesn't stop. And usually, like everyone knows in Alberta, in this area, there's always that spring snowstorm, which could be deadly on ranches for the calves. But yeah, I do have that. I have ones too where they're, you know, unfortunately, they had to have to warm a calf up inside and bottle feed it because the mom had died. So those photos too, I didn't put them in here, but I do have them. I that being said, I do not like being cold, but I do go out there and photograph in the winter. I would not make it photographing the reindeer herders.
No, that's good. Yeah, that's a follow-up comment there. Yeah, yeah. that might make it tricky too.
Yeah.
And someone was surprised that you wouldn't have more, or wouldn't want to have more control over the book, over what went in there. Like, was that a matter of you didn't want to, or was it more of just how books get made, where the editor's just gonna sort through?
That's a good question. I did see I saw the final proof. Honestly, I'm just, that's a really good question. I don't know how to answer it, but I do wish I had more control over how the photos were displayed and what ones got in. My friend Mike Drew that I was mentioning has a book as well, and it was the same for him. I think the problem might have lies with us as photographers is we give them too many photos. And you can only fit so many in a book, or you should, because then you'd have too many. So I think the problem was just probably in my editing, and I'm so busy with, like, when I was working at the newspaper that I just kind of got left to the side, which is purely my downfall for sure.
And with editing your photos, do you spend an awful lot of time doing that? Like, what sort of things do you correct in there? We mentioned a little bit about color choices and that sort of thing, but
yeah. So I don't like to spend a lot of time at the computer just because I like to be out photographing. Because of my photojournalistic background, and I am a photojournalist, we can't change a lot of stuff, and we don't ethically. That being said, changing from color to black and white is fine. We fix some of the shadows. If anyone's familiar with Photoshop, it's like levels, curves, that kind of thing. But other than that, most of these photos I try to get it exact in camera so that I don't have to spend a lot of time at the computer. So like in terms of Photoshop, I know the big fad on like Instagram, let's say, is to put a filter on stuff. These aren't like, as a photojournalist, this is what it looks like, as close to what it looks like as I can make it. So right out of the camera with a couple of different corrections, obviously if I'm putting in black and white, I'll adjust the curves, but not too much that it takes away from what it actually looked like in real life. None of these are with filters or anything like that.
Okay. And sort of with setting up the picture and making sure you capture everything before, so you don't have to go back and do it later. What portion of your photographs are planned versus a capture the moment?
I guess most of the portraits are, I guess nothing's really planned, but the portraits are more planned in that I'm telling them where to stand, or, you know, look at me or don't look at me. So that part is planned and kind of set up. In terms of the other stuff, nothing is really planned. I can have an idea in my head when I go in what it's going to look like. But I mean, you know, I'm, for this one, I didn't plan beforehand that I was going to shoot it that way and put my focus on the horse and the rider, or cut the top of the rider off. I saw that in my frame, and that's how it looks in my frame. Like, it's not cropped after. That's exactly how I'm seeing it, seeing that looking through my viewfinder. So I tend to, yeah, like, even, I'm probably not explaining this well, but like, even with this cowboy boot, I'm super close, and that is exactly how it is out of my camera.
Yeah. And another one, what were the most challenging photos to take for the book?
I don't know if there was, like, I don't think that any of them were challenging. I think the hardest, and not even a hard part, but I guess the biggest part was getting access onto the ranches, Hutterite communities, Indigenous. So I guess, but in terms of, I don't think there was anything that was like the hardest.
And I guess sort of tying into that a little bit here, what was trickier to gain access to? And I know it depends on each specific spot, but to like the Indigenous communities, or to the ranches, or the different Hutterite communities, is there all sort of the same level, or how did you go about doing that?
I'd say they're like not all the same level. I think the Hutterite communities are the hardest for sure, because a lot of them don't want their photographs taken. So that's probably the hardest ones. The rest are the same level, as obviously you're going on to their property, so you need to ask permission. I would never just drive onto a ranch, a colony, Indigenous community without asking permission at all. Because it is, every place I've photographed, except the Stampede maybe, or all that's private, but every place is private property. So obviously I have a big connection, and this has taken over 20 years. So to have some of these connections, and most of these photos I take, most of the ones in the book, I consider these, like, they're all my friends. Like, I consider them,
yeah.
I've known them for so long. Like the one, Dana Hare, she used to be Dana, her maiden name's Jenkins. But again, I started photographing her when she was 10. She's 30 now, so I've known them for a long time. So it's not something that I can recommend to someone just going out and...
Yeah, no. It's not a weekend trip. But...
No, so I guess the hardest part is that the lane, it took a long time. same with Lenore. I've known Lenore for 20 years. And also by knowing one rancher or someone on the colony or something, they put in a good word for me, because they know me and know that I respect, you know, I'm not going to get in their way. So that helps as well.
Yeah, you sort of get that snowballing effect where you totally, meet one person, yeah, have a real connection. And
and I think maybe a bit about my background is I know a little bit about ranching, you know, being exposed to it through my dad's side of the family. So that helps as well.
Yeah. Do you have any exhibitions do you have exhibitions often, or are you associated with any art gallery in Calgary or anything like that?
No, I'd like to, and I was looking into it before COVID hit. It's kind of, COVID has kind of put that on the back burner. But yeah, I'm always open to having an exhibition. It's hard because of my background as a photojournalist. I find it very hard to talk about my own work because it's very personal. And most journalists or photojournalists, when we're behind the camera, it's never about us. It's always about our subjects. So having a show or something like that is it just feels, it's different.
And I guess tying into photojournalism, I say that a lot, sorry, photojournalism.
I know, it's a tongue
twister. Tying in, when you, like, how do you tell the story? That's a terrible question, but because you are capturing history in moments and things like that. Do you, I guess, what sort of story do you feel that this overall project, the book project, came out with? And are you happy with the choices the editors made? Yes, but like for getting that story out there of
Southern Alberta. I mean, it's not the full story of Southern Alberta, and it's not, I guess this in terms of journalistic isn't like really a story of Southern Alberta. It's just my story of Southern Alberta. So it's just my take on places I photographed, and there's still so many other places and people in Southern Alberta that I want to photograph still. So it's not a complete story. But I get where you're going with the photojournalism thing. In photos, I always try to capture, it's about capturing moments, and it's about capturing real moments. So I think, well, I know for this book, that's what I was capturing, is just real moments that were happening in front of me.
And I think before we push on, force on here, we've got one last question here. Are you always framing an image in your head, or can you live in the moment without being behind the lens?
That's a good question. No, I'm always framing a moment in my head. I watch movies, and there are always these moments in my head, or it's always about the light. I think I annoy my friends and family a lot, because when we're walking, I'm like, look at the light, or that would be a great photo. I'm constantly, I love photography so much, and it's my passion, but I'm constantly, I see moments in my life in photos. That's my journal. So even right now I'm seeing this in a photo. The terrible light. Yeah. In
I think I can compete with you on that in my little white cube that I have here.
Mine's a lot of brown and wood.
But it's been very, very interesting to hear both this projects and look at your just stunning photographs, and especially hearing the stories behind there. So thank you very much for sharing that with us.
Thanks for everyone putting up with my nervousness.
Didn't sense it personally, so
good to know.
I guess we got a couple other questions here if you're okay with that.
Sure, yeah,
a couple more here. what else do you like to photograph, or very what good. Don't you like photographing, I guess might be an easier way to put that.
I was gonna say there's nothing I don't like photographing, but I actually don't like studio work, like still life studio work. I'll do it, but I'm not good at it. I have friends who are amazing still life photographers in the studio, but I don't like to photograph that. The other stuff I like to photograph, I photograph a lot of sports. I've covered a few Olympics. But my favorite stuff is traveling the world, documenting different cultures. And just meeting new people. But I love photographing people the most, for sure.
Yeah. Well, thank you very, very much. This has been excellent. So I'd like to thank everybody for joining us this evening. And where can people pick this lovely book up if they wanted to again?
So I want to support local. The Camera Store in Calgary, they have some books there that are already signed. And they're great on 11th Ave Southwest there. And of course, it's still on Amazon and Chapters.
Okay, excellent. Thank you again. And thank you everyone for joining us tonight. We do have more presentations coming up, more programs from the library, including the one next week that was mentioned earlier tonight. You can always explore the calgarylibrary.ca and just go to the programs section there and you can sign up for more of them. And once again, thank you very much, Leah, for sharing with us. And this has been fun.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everyone. Stay safe.